Hi, I'm Sue. I'm here today with Ruoting. We're going to talk about how Microsoft and Duo work together in order to help secure users in a multi-cloud environment. So welcome.
Thanks for having me, Sue. Great to be here.
Some viewers might be surprised that we're sitting here together today since we both have multi-factor authentication solutions. Microsoft has come to realize and accept that a heterogeneous environment is normal for our customers and that choice is actually good for our customers.
Yeah, I think that's a really great point. Even on the Duo side, what we've seen over the last, I would say, 5-10 years is that there's broader macro trends around consumerization of IT that our customers are experiencing every single day. And a lot of that is brought on by a reduction in the friction of being able to use different enterprise tooling. And so customers are much more willing to use best-in-breed tooling for each specific problem that they're looking to solve. And as a result, interoperability really is the name of the game. And so we're thrilled to be partnering with Microsoft across a variety of different solutions to help customers solve some of the really hardest problems that they're seeing in their environment today.
So how do you think the partnership's going?
I think it's been a very fruitful partnership. Duo and Microsoft launched our first partnership and the first integration about 2.5 years ago. And it was really around enabling Microsoft customers that were moving from on-premises Active Directory into Azure Active Directory to allow them to have the same security efficacy and the same security policy and leverage the same security investments that they had made in the on-prem world as they transitioned to the cloud. What we wanted to make sure was that from a security vendor perspective, we weren't the bottleneck in helping customers make the digital transformation and move to the cloud. And so we had to have kind of feature parity, so to speak, of all the things that a customer could enable for their security posture on premises. We wanted to make sure that that was the same case for the cloud environment when they went over to Office 365, Azure Active Directory, and so on and so forth. So I think it's been a very fruitful partnership.
Tell me a little bit about University of Michigan.
University of Michigan has actually been a longtime Duo customer for a while. They were actually one of our first customers. Today, we protect about 75,000 user accounts at the University of Michigan. That includes, you know, the undergrad population, the graduate population, as well as their staff and faculty. As you can imagine, in higher education, it's not just unique to University of Michigan, but you have a lot of your students don't necessarily care about cybersecurity and good password hygiene. And so U of M initially came to us to stop a lot of account takeover and credential theft scenarios that they were seeing. Today, we integrate with Microsoft Azure AD, as well as Office 365, to protect student and faculty logins to their email, to other Office 365 collaboration tools, as well as to anything that is actually federating against their Azure AD instance.
So you mentioned that students don't care about cybersecurity, or they don't care about their passwords. We find that that's true for everyone. It's not just students.
Yes, it absolutely is true. I think phishing training and security awareness has become a much more prevalent part of corporations today, and because cybersecurity really is kind of at the center of a lot of issues that that we see. I think it's a good thing that there is as much awareness around this as we see today, and I hope it continues.
Yeah, and I think what we've seen is, you know, what's now is the security perimeter moving away from being on-prem to being everywhere. So you're working mobile, you have all kinds of users, all kinds of devices, so it really requires that we think about security in a broad way. So, you know, let's talk about zero trust for a second. Zero trust is a concept that spans the entire ecosystem, and it's impossible for one vendor to do it all.
As one of the de facto cloud platform providers for customers, Duo really wanted to work with Microsoft to make sure that as customers were moving to the Microsoft cloud, that they could take the same security principles that they had on premises and apply them to the Microsoft cloud. For us, zero trust really is around a couple of principles. One, it's establishing the identity of the user as they're accessing the application. Two is establishing that you can trust the device or the endpoint that they are using as they're accessing those applications. And the last piece of it is really where the interoperability comes in, which is that it doesn't matter or it shouldn't matter where that application or that workload is hosted. That application could be hosted on premises, it could be in a data center somewhere, it could be in the Microsoft cloud, it could be in the Google cloud, it really doesn't matter. But the idea is really to be able to secure those users and those devices accessing those applications no matter where they are. And that's really the fundamental challenge or the fundamental premise around zero trust. For me personally, what kind of the necessary means in the context of Duo is a few things. One is radical empathy for everyone that we work with. So that's not just limited to our customers. We obviously are customer first, and so there's a lot of customer empathy, but it also means employee empathy. And I think that is actually very important in terms of fostering an environment where diversity and inclusion can really thrive. So for us, it's about fostering an environment where people are comfortable taking risks, right? That they're not going to be penalized for taking a risk and failing. It's about embracing failure. It's about encouraging people to learn the lessons that are associated with when something doesn't work out. So that's the first part. The second part of that is assuming positive intent. Now, there's a lot of scenarios in the business world where we don't have the context into everything that happens 24/7, 365, and we often are seeing a small sliver of the outcome of a set of actions that were taken. And it's very easy to assume negative intent, actually. And so one of the things that we try to do, and we practice very consciously at Duo, is assuming positive intent, meaning, you know, taking a step back, trying to understand from the other person or the other team's point of view in terms of why they made the decisions that they made, and having the belief that everyone really is on the same core mission of advancing the company forward, and that we have different perspectives on how we're going to get there, but ultimately everyone is focused on the same thing.
As I hear you talk, I hear things that remind me of Hit Refresh by Satya Nadella. He talks about his own journey to develop empathy. And I think that's one of the things we're working hard at Microsoft, is to build our culture to be kinder, gentler as well. In fact, we use the OKR, Objectives and Key Results model, for our goal setting. And both at the cloud and AI division level and for identity, we have our first objective is about people and about making sure people can bring their authentic self to work.
Yeah, it's one of the core principles within the Duo culture is actively thinking about diversity and inclusion. And I'm curious, as a female in tech, what has your experience been with diversity and inclusion?
Well, it's a topic that's near and dear to me. It is one of Microsoft's culture pillars, and it's one that we're working on hard at Microsoft. I think that one of my personal ahas was going from being a person that was in it to stepping out and saying, what's my role in that? And I realized that as a woman in tech, that I've assimilated to, you know, be more like the rest of the engineers rather than just be myself. And as we've learned what the experience of some of the other women that are more early in career have had, I realized I've gotten used to it. A lot of us had that realization that, well, that's just the way it is. What's up with that? And then when you realize that that's really not okay to just accept that we're supposed to act differently because we're in a man's world. What I did is I went and I got a certification from eCornell on D&I because I felt like I didn't have the tools. I had grown up in it. I had been assimilated, as I said, and so it was much easier for me to go take a class, be able to actually use words like assimilation, differentiation, talk about what it means to have psychological safety, and equip me in a way that I could help my peers and help my team. I guess what I would say overall is it's been a realization that I had to start with myself. I had to really look at the fact that I have biases, that I have done some of the things that I accuse other people of doing to me, and then really stepping back and observing that, and then, like I said, getting the certification so I felt like I was actually in a position to help others.
I think it's fascinating that you bring up the tools piece. For me, as a male in tech, the first thing was recognition of unconscious biases, right, that we all have.
I went to a gender speak training, and one of the things they talked about is that, whether you believe this or not, but it resonated with me, is men are goal oriented and women are process oriented. And so what it'll turn out to be is a man will come in and ask a woman, let's go do this project. And then she'll start asking a bunch of questions. And the man's thought bubble is, well, she's not bought in. Why is she asking all these questions? Why doesn't she just go do it? And what the woman is actually doing is gathering information. That's okay, because she's going to go do it, but she just wants to know what to do to move forward. And that's the process-oriented piece. I actually went to in Vegas once, one of these Defending the Caveman shows, and they talked about men are hunters and women are gatherers. Even in shopping, men go in, shoot the shirt, buy it, walk out. Women walk in and go, oh, a new line of socks. Oh, did you see they now have that line in black? And a woman will actually traverse a store in a very different way than a man, because they have these different objectives. So anyway, back to the story. So the idea is that if women are process oriented, they're going to collect a lot of information. And so I go back to my office, and literally it was like half a day later, I get a mail from an executive who said, hey, is there a way that we can find customers that have at least 5 SaaS apps that are doing blah, 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 looking for some specific solution opportunity? And my first thought was, okay, well, do you want to see people who have a premium license? Do you want to talk to customers that are in the enterprise, or do you want to look at small and medium businesses? Are you thinking about people that are global, or should we start in North America? And I start writing this mail with a bunch of questions, and then I realized that I was doing exactly what I had heard in this seminar. And I thought, okay, I'm going to rewrite this. So I go, okay, I'm going to get on it. My assumptions are we're going to look at premium licenses, we're going to do enterprise customers first, and let's start with North America. Does that work for you? And so I wrote it so that I was going out to, you know, shoot the shirt rather than gather the information, but I did it by, you know, writing down my assumptions rather than asking a bunch of questions. So a big difference, just a pivot, but a big difference.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that is the reason why diversity is actually so important in the modern workplace today, right? I think back to your example, and I frame it in the context of design thinking, where you kind of have convergent thinking and you have divergent thinking. Some people are better at convergent thinking, other people are better at divergent thinking. But you really need both to be able to actually get to the best solution possible. Things like diversity and inclusion and how we approach our problem solving, I think are very closely tied together. And frankly, I think we need more women in the workplace to help us look at a broader set of solutions. Because to your point, men do tend to be more goal-oriented. So we start, you know, at the starting line, and we have the finish line in mind. We know what we're looking for, and it's just about what is the path to getting there. But sometimes that path, the most efficient path, is not the best path, right? And it does take some divergence to and risk, and it takes a culture that rewards risk-taking to look for alternate paths that might actually end up being better for our customers, for our partners, for our employees, for everyone involved.
I'm a voracious reader, so I'm wondering if you have a recommendation for me to put on my list.
I do. I recently just finished When Breath Becomes Air by Paul Kalanithi. It's a memoir about a Stanford neurosurgeon that actually discovers that he has stage 4 lung cancer in his last year of residency. And so the whole book is kind of an autobiography of him kind of trying to discover his purpose and what everything is for. It's about his reflections on his work-life balance. As, obviously, as most people know, when you're in residency, you work nonstop, and to find out that you have stage 4 lung cancer in your final year is pretty heartbreaking. It's about him reconnecting with his wife and his children. And he also happens to actually be an English major from Stanford. And so the prose of the book is just absolutely beautiful. It's a pretty short read, but it definitely has become one of my favorite books of all time.
Well, thank you. And I'll definitely put that on my list. And thank you, Ruoting, for spending the time with me here today.
Yeah, thanks for talking with me. It was a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.